Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, our distinguished guests, a warm welcome.
J'aimerais vous accueillir chaleureusement cette deuxième journée de notre conférence, chaleureusement pour ceux d'entre vous qui venez pour la première fois.
Just a reminder about our translation channels. We have English on channel 1, we have French on channel 2, we have Spanish in channel 3, and Russian on channel 4. So kindly use the channel of your convenience. And if there are any challenges, please let us know. We'll be here to be of assistance. My name is Tweety Uzele. I'm Senior Knowledge and Learning Officer with the LLI leadership team. And it's my pleasure to host you as MC for the second day. Now, as we start our official program this morning, our theme is Accelerating Impact of the World Bank Operations through Country-Led Knowledge Sharing. And we will start into our first plenary session this morning, which is titled Galvanizing International Support to Country-Led Knowledge Sharing, and very specifically, how knowledge sharing can support the achievements of the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals. So really building on to what was laid as a foundation yesterday. So it's my pleasure this morning to welcome up the panelists for session 5, who are Maria Gonzalez de Assis, who's the Lead Operations Officer, Global Delivery Initiative here at the World Bank. Please join me in welcoming up Maria Gonzalez de Assis. Our next distinguished guest is Amadeus Kamagenge, who's Director of Community Support, Tanzania Social Action Fund in Tanzania. Please join us at the podium. Is he in? Okay, I'd seen him at breakfast, but okay. Next, we'll welcome up our next panelist, distinguished panelist, Ian Thorpe, who is Chief Learning and Knowledge Exchange Policy at the United Nations Children's Fund, UNICEF. Please join us at the front. Warm welcome. Our third distinguished panelist is Salhi Elboni, who's Director General, Tunisian Agency for Technical Cooperation in Tunisia. Warm welcome. And to moderate this session for us, we have Karen Mokade, who's Division Chief on Knowledge Management, Inter-American Development Bank. Warm welcome, Karen.
Good morning, everyone. It's wonderful to be here on a spring Washington morning where the sun has actually come out. And I'm really pleased to be here to follow up on the fruitful exchange that we had yesterday, a lot of insights on the contribution that knowledge sharing can make to development programs and projects. And I think today we have a lot of opportunity to build on that and continue to look at the how can we do this? How can we effectively bring insights from different levels of experience in order to replicate good practices, to continue to explore promising solutions? So we have a wonderful panel today. And before we begin, I'd just like to take the opportunity to thank the World Bank and the government of the Republic of Korea for bringing together the best experience that is in this room and the opportunity to exchange. I thank them for inviting the Inter-American Development Bank to participate, and I'm really looking forward to hearing from our panelists. The group before us, and we know that Amadeus is in the room, so is in the building, so we're hoping to have him on stage in just a minute. But we have the advantage of bringing together experience from the national government at the agency level, National Agency for Technical Cooperation, and then two representatives from multilaterals in order to reflect on the contribution that knowledge sharing can make to the achievement of the 2030 agenda, and most specifically to the achievement of the Sustainable Development Goals. So we're going to try to build on what we consider to be a consensus. I think in yesterday's closing session, we agreed that there is general consensus on the contribution and the value of knowledge sharing. And we want to move on then to look at a little bit of the who's and the how's and the challenges that we face in promoting that. And I'm trying to remember what Jean-Claude painted as the vision of knowledge management yesterday. Instant, relevant content in context, I think was. And the hows of doing that is what I hope that we can get to in the panel today. So starting out is always probably the most difficult. So I'm going to allow the person who is in-house to start out. Maria Gonzalez de Assis is the lead operations officer here at the World Bank and leads an interagency effort in knowledge sharing to improve implementation. Maria. Well, let me just mention one thing. I forgot to mention the two questions that we asked the panelists to address. And we asked each of them to mention how they consider that country institutions can contribute their experience, their good practices, and their promising solutions to the achievement of the Sustainable Development Goals. And how can multilateral and bilateral agencies support the country-led efforts in order to create an exponential effect on the learning process?
Thank you, Karen. Well, let me start just by thank you very much to all of you. I think this is a great opportunity for learning, especially for institutions like the World Bank, that we are here in a way of listening to all of you and learn from you, from your experiences and connecting with each other, so we can improve the way that we are also doing business inside the World Bank and for supporting our countries. You know, when we wake up every morning, at least I think most of us that are here, we have very good intentions. We have even a very good expertise, the technical knowledge, even financial resources to support the interventions that we wanted to make a change, the reforms that we wanted to have an impact, if it's maternal mortality or is reduced maternal mortality or is scaling our rural sanitation or any other reform. However, there is something that happened during implementation that there is a gap that, and we don't know exactly what is this gap, that really is an obstacle for having the result that we expected. And we, during the last 2 years, we have been working very hard to understand how we can capture the delivery insights of what happened during implementation. When we, with the best intentions, with the best technical knowledge, with the best financial resources, we don't achieve what we want to achieve. And let me just put you an example. Scaling our rural sanitation. In many countries for the last, in the past, many organizations, including the World Bank and others, were trying to provide subsidies as a measure to improve scaling our rural sanitation in many countries. Subsidies to buy latrines. However, this measure were not having the impact expected because they were not using the latrines. We were just assuming that by doing the same thing over and over, by giving subsidies, we were going to solve the problem. And we failed in terms of thinking what were the delivery insights, the behavioral incentives, the other social norms that were happening, because knowledge is very contextual, in countries to really learn from that and to adapt to particular countries and to scaling up what was the solution for different countries in scaling our rural sanitation. So in the last year, a global initiative was created in the area of water scaling our rural sanitation to create three pilot learning programs, observatories, to to see what and reflect during implementation what was happening, learning, and scaling up these innovations. Now, after these interventions, more than 13 countries now have get scaling up rural sanitation in the countries, and this is just an example of what it means to capture the delivery insights of implementation. And what we saw yesterday is that our knowledge is fragmented, our knowledge is not systematized and captured properly, that we don't know exactly what happened during the implementation and these delivery insights. We focus too much on the technical aspect, but not on the tacit knowledge, not on what happened to see during the implementation of our interventions. And we see that the problems are complex. The context is the most important thing during the our interventions, and also for knowledge. And all of these things make us think about what can we do as a community to really think in a different way of doing development. So 2 years ago, and sorry, one and a half years ago, during the spring meetings, we launched what we call the Global Delivery Initiative, which is a collaboration among different countries, institutions, organizations, academics, to bring together the cumulative knowledge around the how, around implementation, at the very granular level and understand what is going on. And for that, I just wanted to give you several components and areas that we work together on doing that, on the how that Karen was talking about. The first measure was to create, or we are in the process of co-creating with these 30 organizations that are part of the Global Delivery Initiative, a common language, a common taxonomy for working on development challenges and delivery challenges. The development challenges are easy because the development challenges, the Sustainable Development Goals. There are 17 Sustainable Development Goals. On the delivery challenges, we are in the process of co-creating a taxonomy, analyzing more in the bank, more than 5,000 projects from 1994, around 90% of all the projects that we have in the bank, to identify what are the most common delivery challenges that happen during implementation. And we're collaborating with DFID, with African Development Bank, with the Asian Development Bank, with the IDB, and with GIZ, and with others, to really bring this taxonomy, this common language together, to understand what are the most common delivery challenges. Now we have a category around 17 the delivery challenges at the granular level. So a common language, very, very important, if we wanted to create this common knowledge around the how, around implementation. The second thing is what we call the global library around delivery. And again, focus on delivery, on the knowledge around, the tacit knowledge of implementation. So what we can capture, then we have co-created together again, and this is not an initiative from the bank, it's an initiative from the world for the world and for the practitioners. We have co-created common guidelines on how to write these case studies, and these are available for all of you. Very, very simple guidelines that now all the partners from GDI are contributing to, not only on the case studies per se, using the common language of development challenges, the delivery challenges, and the how to, going through the process tracing of implementation and understanding well what is going on during the process, but also using these cases to connect, as an excuse to connect practitioners with each other and to create communities around different areas of reducing, and not on projects of or intervention, but problems. So, migration, scaling up rural sanitation, reducing maternal mortality, all of the sustainable development goals. And what we are trying to create is these communities of practice around delivery. So that's the second thing. The third thing that we have is a capacity building program on adaptive implementation to get the feedback loops on how the government, we are working with the Chilean government, with the Colombian government, and with others to really understand how they are you are doing adaptive implementation. We wanted to capture that and learn and really use this knowledge for connecting with other practitioners. So this capacity building is in two areas, for case studies and also for doing adaptive implementation. We have also a multi-sectoral approach for identifying and working with complex problems. So migration or nutrition, we try to facilitate a process where we bring different stakeholders to the table to discuss the problem and go through a process where they themselves or you yourself find solutions. So we have the library, the multi-stakeholder approach, the common language and taxonomy and the delivery challenges. And with all these delivery challenges, what we are now trying to do is to predict in a way with historical data, what are the most common delivery challenges when you are intervening in a project or doing or trying to solve a problem. What are the most? What are the predictions that you are going to be able to do based on the historical data of other interventions that you have in the past? So you have some idea first on that. And second, connect with all the practitioners that you have tried to deal with that particular problem. So I think we are working in this initiative together with more than 30 organizations. Again, this is not an initiative from the World Bank. It's an initiative from practitioners to practitioners, and I invite all of you to be part of this initiative because I think it's a way to connect all the country-led knowledge that you are doing at the global level and then fit again your reforms and your initiatives and the way that we are having an impact on the Sustainable Development Goals.
Thank you, Maria. We're now going to hear from Amadeus Kamagangi. Amadeus, thank you for joining us. And Amadeus is the Director of Community Programs at the Tanzanian Social Action Fund. And again, we're looking to hearing from you in terms of your initiatives to share good practices and promising solutions.
Thank you. Distinguished delegates, organizers of this event. First, I would like to thank you so much for providing an opportunity to attend and share what we are doing in Tanzania in relation to country-led knowledge sharing initiatives. I share an initiative which is somewhat unique, meaning that knowledge sharing among the population which is largely not literate. Those who cannot read, write, this is what I'm going to share with and how international support and partners are working with the government. The government of the United Republic of Tanzania is implementing a program which is called Productive Social Safety Net. It's a program which is targeting the extreme poor and food insecure. And in connection with SDGs, it's contributing to directly to 9 goals. Number 1 to number 6, and then one on climate change, governance, gender equality. So this program is combining 3 interventions. The objective is to ensure that these extreme poor and food insecure families ultimately graduate out of poverty. Of course, provide support, transfers to smoothen consumption, then support the same families to engage labor-intensive public works, and then ultimately, the same families are supposed to participate in productive inclusion initiatives. But in relation to our subject of knowledge sharing, the challenge that we had with this population is a program which is supporting about 15% of the population of Tanzania, about 6 million people. The challenge is that looking at the characteristics of the population which is supported, looking at women, around 46% of women who are supported cannot read and write. And about 31% of men who are supported can't also read and write. So in order to make sure that knowledge is shared among these beneficiaries, we introduced sessions. And you see, we had to deliberately introduce these sessions for knowledge sharing, because typically, when these families are invited to a village meeting, they always don't attend such meetings. So since we deliver payment of cash benefits every 2 months, we designed in the program that just before delivering cash payment, there is an allowance of 15 to 30 minutes where knowledge can be shared, there can be interaction, and thereafter, if specific follow-up or more detailed sharing is required, then we have committees that can visit a specific family and continue with dialogue. Indeed, this initiative has been very effective. Steve yesterday had video, but we didn't prepare video. But you can see changes when you compare the way when we started and how we're faring now. But again, ensuring that there is vertical sharing. So we have teams of experts from the national level, because the governance structure is decentralized. We have the national level, we have the local government level, district level, and then community level. So we have experts from the national level who convene quarterly and share and exchange. But again, they have viz where they visit districts, interact with fellow colleagues at the district level, and on a sample basis, they also visit communities and interact and share with beneficiaries. But that is on the part of the experts. On the political, we make sure that when sessions, for instance, at the district level, the councillors meet, one of the areas, one of the agenda or discussions involve sharing on what is emerging either from the community level or from the national level. So you also have dialogue at different levels. And in terms of international support, the government is working with about 10 partners, of course, including the World Bank, DFID, CEDA Sweden, USAID, from the UN, UNICEF, UNDP, ILO, UNFPA, others who are just in discussion of joining EU, government of Finland. But there are other agencies that are not participating directly, but through other organizations like FAO, which is supporting a firm called Fundación Capital. This is specifically focusing on financial inclusion and productive inclusion, and trying to use technology also to facilitate knowledge sharing. So in a nutshell, this is the initiative which we have taken to make sure that there is knowledge sharing even among those who cannot read and write. Of course, the challenge for a country like Tanzania, which is vast, some of the communities, some of the families are located very far from the urban centers. Some are even 300 kilometers away, 400 kilometers away. But we make sure that it's happening. We have committees. We've done capacity building to more than 150,000 committee members and the staff within the local government authorities. So in a nutshell, this is what we are doing and making sure that we are working with and bringing in some international experience. Thank you so much.
A beautiful example of how knowledge sharing can start at the very community level and build its way up. And eventually a clear synergy with something that could then scale it globally through the GDI. Thank you. I'm going to hand the floor to Ian Thorpe from UNICEF. Thank you, Ian, for sharing your perspectives.
Great, thanks. So thanks very much to the World Bank and to the Korean Ministry of Strategy and Finance for inviting me to come. I think it's really good that the UN, someone from the UN is here. I don't know if there are any other UN colleagues. It's good to be able to share some thoughts, but it's even more interesting to hear from all of you about the kind of work that you're doing to see how to make this kind of knowledge sharing work really relevant and to be really helpful for you. I wanted to start out by just saying a couple of things about the SDGs and the nature of the SDGs in terms of knowledge sharing. And the reason I say that is that we had the Millennium Development Goals, and now we have this very kind of bold new agenda that is very, very inclusive, has many different aspects to it. Some of the stuff is familiar, and we've been doing knowledge sharing around the MDGs for quite some time, and we know in some of the areas we know solutions and we've made good progress. But in the SDGs, there's a number of new areas that are not so familiar, where we need to not only share knowledge, technical knowledge about what works, but we need to generate knowledge. And that the reason that's important for this is that that knowledge isn't coming necessarily from academia or from kind of Western experts or this kind of thing. It's coming from country experience on the ground. And so it becomes, country-led knowledge sharing becomes particularly important in the context of the SDGs. And I just wanted to mention a couple of areas particularly where that's the case. So I think one important issue is that Maria touched on is that a lot of the challenges, even in not achieving the MDGs, were not necessarily around technical knowledge about what works and what doesn't work. It was around implementation challenges and kind of getting solutions put into practice in a way that suits the context. And so I think this thinking about the unfinished business of the MDGs and the SDGs, we really need to look now at this when we talked yesterday about tacit knowledge, about what is it that makes things work in practice, not just what makes things work in theory. And I think that's a shift in a lot of the thinking about how we share knowledge around development and that we really need to push forward. The other aspect, which perhaps it goes to the example from Tanzania a little bit, is that related to the implementation challenges, a lot of the challenges are about reaching the unreached and about equity. So that's a different thing from trying to build a kind of a national health service or a national infrastructure. You're really looking at who are the people that were missed out by the big push and were not reached, and how do we find them, and how do we listen to them and give them a voice. And so I think, again, this requires a different approach to knowledge sharing than some of the approaches we've taken in the past, because you really have to figure out what is it that makes a difference so that we can now reach everybody with the goals and not just the large proportion of the population. And the third thing I wanted to mention is both the source of knowledge that is used in development, but we need to look at the knowledge around how to do this, is the so-called data revolution. So we have a lot of traditional data collection and statistics that has been going on, and we continue to do statistical capacity development. But what's kind of exciting now is a lot of stuff around real-time data collection and how do we do real-time data collection to affect local decision-making. And there's lots of really exciting experience out in the field, but it's all very disconnected. And how do we get that, and how do we match that with the statistics? And another aspect of that is not just real-time monitoring, say, from inside clinics or inside schools, but it's also real-time monitoring of of opinions of the population, giving the population a voice, the excluded population. So, how long did they have to wait for hospital treatment and those kinds of things? So I'm just giving this as a perspective. These are some emerging areas where we need to be looking at sharing knowledge about how to do these areas well. And I think there's a couple of things. So there are many ways to do this, but there are two major ways that people talk about. And one is about trying to capture tacit knowledge. So that is doing case studies, documenting experience. And I think initiatives such as the Global Delivery Initiative are very good for doing this. And I think there's a good push to kind of identify some of that. I think the other aspect of that is that some tacit knowledge can't be captured at all. And so one of the things we need to do is to foster conversations between people who are implementing things. And I think case studies can often be the start of that conversation, but you need to go beyond that and look at things like how do you build communities and build trust among practitioners so that they can learn from each other and want to learn from each other and help each other to achieve what they're trying to achieve. So I'm saying this all at a very theoretical level, and I'm going to give a practical example at the end, so I don't just talk at a theoretical level. But this is the kind of thing. So the thing for me is, well, and maybe just to say also about the communities and about one other thing that people talk about a lot is platforms, so technology platforms, and everybody loves this, another knowledge sharing technology platform. You know, our executive director wants us to create one in a certain area of South-South cooperation, and we're going to do that. But the thing for me is that we have to be avoid being too focused on platform. A platform is a means to an end, and it's a good place to find and aggregate information, but it's really the behavior of people around the platform that matters as much as the platform itself. And I think one of the things here that was mentioned several times yesterday is to invest in facilitation. So by facilitation, I mean online facilitation and offline facilitation. So how do we get people to, how do we engage people with content, with case studies, with communities? And I think we put a lot around documents about having, you know, reports or having platforms and places to put stuff. But I think we need to equally focus on what's the methodology and the incentives for people around using those things. A little bit on some of the roles of the internet. We had a workshop on this, on a similar topic in UNICEF recently, about what was our role in fostering South-South cooperation and government-to-government cooperation. And we basically came around five things that we were going to work on. So one is this content curation. So this is knowing what works well. And I think it's a good role for the international community, because the international organizations, because when we're everywhere, we have access to find out what everyone is doing. So we can naturally bring that together in the same way that the World Bank has brought together this meeting. So content curation, of finding that content and having a central hub and standards for it is one thing. But the other part that goes to the second thing I was discussing is a convener of conversations and communities. And I think that's, again, like this is a community of practice of people who are working on knowledge sharing. And I think convening people, bringing people together in communities to have conversations is something that and not necessarily in a formal way, because we quite often have these formal set piece meetings, but I think what we need to have is meetings where we really get to the substance of what we're doing. The third thing we came up with was being a matchmaker. So a matchmaker meaning, well, so knowledge sharing is demand driven. A country comes to us in UNICEF and said, well, we want to know about how to, you know, make our social protection system more child friendly. Then the role we can play is to help find the expertise that's needed to support that, and which is the right country and which are the right partners, and how do we do the introductions. And I think that can be both at a government to government or organization to organization level, but sometimes it's just, this is a professor who's worked on this before, or this is some other person. And I think matchmaking is something that we need to kind of invest more in doing, in being we're kind of like a dating service for development, I will put it that way, right? And then the fourth role we had, which is relationship support, because just because you start a relationship and you go on a first date doesn't mean that it's not hard to work on a relationship between two countries that are far away and have their own priorities. So how, one of the things is to help support, it can be logistically, financially, technically, but how do we help make good relationships and how do we set the ground so that those relationships can blossom? The last role we have is a bit of maybe a controversial one, but I'll explain it, which is influence. And the influence here is this about this issue of equity, for example. So it's, if you're reforming your social protection system, how do you make sure that it is actually reaches the poorest and reaches children? And I think we take advantage of that because we advocate on behalf of children to kind of both give the evidence as to why it matters, and also show other examples to say, look, some other country has been able to do this, even though you think it's not, it may be politically difficult or expensive, we can show you how it can be done, and we can try and make you do, you know, help you to do the right thing that you want to do. So I think we have a role in this in helping achieve those goals. I wanted to bring this together now in a kind of one concrete example of one project that we're working on, which is around real-time data collection in four countries in Eastern and Southern Africa. So it's Swaziland, Zimbabwe, Uganda, and Kenya. And what we're doing is we're working with local health clinics, and we're getting them to collect data in real time as people come into the clinic, and then presenting that data in dashboards for them to make decisions. And the important thing here is not just collecting the data, but is working with them to get them to regularly review that data and make decisions with that data. And the other thing we're combining it with is data from the people who come into the clinics about what they thought about the service they had, and you know, how long they had to wait, those kinds of things. So getting both citizen feedback and feedback from the service providers, but at local level. So it's not about national decision making, it's about helping people month to month look at their data and make real decisions. So we designed this project, it's funded by the Gates Foundation, to try to really look at how do you combine these different kinds of data to make quick progress in reaching the kind of unreached and in tackling some of the critical issues in health in the SDGs. And what was interesting is one of the things we did was we designed it as a learning project from the outset. So we said we were going to document lessons learned, not formally through evaluations, but we were going to capture the knowledge from the project as it happens and share it with the other countries and with countries outside in the region. So we are taking an approach that we're building a community of practice of the four countries and looping in other countries that are doing this work but are not part of the grant to share that knowledge, and then we're working with it over time. So we have documented case studies, but they're very quick case studies and they're really focused on what went wrong, or when you planned this project, you thought it was going to go this way and it went a different way. What's the reason for that? So you're really focused around having this ongoing sharing, having a community of practice. And the idea is to build this out and invite more and more countries to join this work. Each country has a different design, because what they need to do in this area is contextual to how their health system works and how people consume health services. So it's not the single design, but it's the same principles, but in each individual approach. And the other thing that we're doing in the project is getting the countries to teach each other. Some countries are stronger in some areas and some are stronger in others. So what we do is we build a learning agenda and then have all the countries teach each other about those areas. And then if we need to bring in external expertise in some area where all the countries need support, we bring in that external expertise. So this is just one I want to illustrate that we took a project this way. And I think the key, what's a couple of the key lessons on for me in taking this is you need to plan knowledge sharing not as a knowledge sharing project, but as part of any kind of project especially in an emerging new area where we don't know the solutions, that you need to plan in the knowledge sharing as an integral component of the project, not just as a separate activity, and that this focusing on having people learn from each other, go their own way, but identify common principles around which people can unite and discuss. And again, the mixture between both, a lot of this is tacit knowledge across the board, but tacit knowledge that you capture and write down, and then eventually you evaluate and you publish academically, and then tacit knowledge that you never write down, but what you do is you have people talk to each other on an ongoing basis and build a relationship such that they each help each other be successful. And I think that's the message I really wanted to share with you about some of the things we think we could work together on in improving knowledge sharing. Thanks.
Thank you, Ian. And now we're going to hear from Salih Al-Gourni from the Tunisian Agency for Technical Cooperation.
Good morning. Bonjour tout le monde.
Good morning, everyone. First of all, I'd like to tell you that I will be speaking in French this morning. You will be needing your headsets, therefore. For once, the English booth will be working up there. First of all, I'd like to thank the World Bank and the Korean government for having arranged this event that has brought together high-level decision makers from different countries to discuss a topic that I'm very much interested in, that we are very much interested in, which is knowledge sharing. Yesterday I heard someone speak about culture, that culture eats knowledge as a meal. But I would say that's not the case. Culture develops and contributes to the creation of knowledge. And I can say that is the case from being from Tunisia, Tunisia being in North Africa, along the shores of the Mediterranean, which was the crossroads of trade, has been the crossroads of trade and civilization for so many years. We have been independent since 1966. In 1961, Tunisia passed a law that would allow Tunisian government agencies to better share their own experiences and knowledge with each other, and particularly with other African and Arab nations. I can also tell you that when Mauritania gained its independence, they had no education agencies in place. And so the Tunisian government decided to send teachers over to Mauritania using army planes, military planes, to send Tunisian teachers over to Mauritania. We were not using our military equipment for military means, but to share knowledge, to share know-how with Mauritania. Tunisia has a wealth of natural resources, but limited natural resources as well. In many areas, we have to rely on human resources. And therefore, Tunisia has built up a very solid education system and has passed a law rendering school compulsory for all Tunisian citizens. In 1972, Tunisia created a new agency, the Technical Cooperation Agency. It has a twofold mission. The first mission being to help place Tunisian workers and experts abroad. Every year, about 3,000 Tunisians head out in the Arab world and elsewhere in Europe, Canada, to provide their knowledge and expertise. The second aspect of our mission has to do with South-South cooperation. There as well, we have had great success in carrying out that mission. We don't have limitless resources, but with the little we have and the bit of expertise we have, the bit of know-how, we have been able to share that with our neighbors, Arab and African neighbors. Every year, we organize training programs for 300 to 400 business leaders in Africa. We work with various donors for that, including the African Development Bank, the Islamic Development Bank, and several others. We have been able to work with almost all sectors in for these training programs: agriculture, women's issues, all ministries, all areas. I won't go into detail on what those different training programs covered, but to summarize, something that started out as a pilot program has become standardized now. In 2003, we organized another pilot program with the Islamic Development Bank, working with a Tunisian NGO. We were working on preventable blindness. It was a 3-month pilot program, and it succeeded. It was a success. We therefore concluded that we should extend the scope of that program. We now have the goal of seeing 50,000 African patients. At this stage, We've worked with over 350,000 beneficiaries. We also were able to train trainers in Africa, train leaders and service providers in working to prevent preventable blindness. We find that it should always be a priority, sharing our knowledge. We've been able to share our knowledge in the framework of three programs in particular. One with the Arab Development Fund. That was a program to implement an investment plan in Gabon. We also work with the African Development Bank and that's in relation to the education system in Chad. And we have even spent our own money on that project, our own government's money on that project. We also have worked in the area of environment. But to conclude, I will say one thing. Sharing knowledge is a duty of each and every one of us. This is not a privilege. It's not a gift. If we want to meet our goals, if we want to meet the Agenda 2030 goals, we need to consider that sharing knowledge is an obligation. It's a duty. The other thing I wanted to say is that our agency, the Tunisian Technical Cooperation Agency, and Tunisia itself are there willing to engage with those who would like to share in this work, who would like to join this work to share knowledge. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Salih. I think your concluding comments are an inspiration to continue really this commitment to sharing, but also provide a segue to help us think of something that we reflected about in the concluding session yesterday, which is a little bit about, and how are we going to recognize if we're successful in these efforts? I think all of us recognize that we're sharing knowledge to promote learning around the challenges, the implementation challenges, the challenges of reaching the unreached, of learning from the communities. But the question of then how that knowledge is being used and how we can recognize that it's being a contributor to the SDGs is fundamental, I think. And so I wanted to ask each of the panelists if they would share their thoughts on how we might recognize success of our knowledge sharing programs. Anyone want to?
Thank you very much. This is a very, very important question because it's not enough to share without looking at the impact which you're making when you share. Probably again going to the same program that I had cited at that time, and I should say I had intended to introduce to you the chief executive of that program. Actually, I have been privileged to travel with him. You can wave, Mr. Mamanga. He's the chief executive of that program. Much as we have this intervention, which is facilitating knowledge sharing, but we implement it hand in hand with monitoring and evaluation. So we make sure that we follow up. Of course, it's another team to be able to track the changes that we are making. But besides this day-to-day monitoring, we also have three randomized control trials, impact evaluations. One is specifically looking at how this is impacting on the empowerment of women. Another one is related to HIV/AIDS, because some of the messages shared are targeting the adolescent. So we have another randomized controlled trial impact evaluation looking at the adolescent in addition to the overall impact evaluation. So this monitoring evaluation. But we also have a communication team which follows up these families and documented stories on changes. And some of these stories are shared using the media. We work very close with the media to be able to indicate the change that indeed when the program started, when I was enrolled in the program, how it's faring, and some of the changes that can be seen vividly. These are some of the ways that we're using to be able to track and show the changes that we get through sharing this knowledge on various areas.
This is a topic which we could discuss at great length, and in fact, I had a couple of discussions about it over the dinner yesterday. Just one quick thing to say for me about knowledge sharing that makes it different from some other kinds of interventions is it's a catalytic intervention. It's not something that has a fixed rate of return. So this means it's difficult to track, because what happens is you share knowledge and many times nothing happens, but then one time out of 10 or something, something really significant happens that really transforms. So I think the way to look at, if we're really looking at the impact of this, I mean, you can measure how many documents you produced, how many people logged onto your community of practice, and that's all useful for monitoring your process and is your process good and efficient, but it doesn't tell you of the value. And I think the value, the only way to really collect the value is, the example that you just gave is the stories of people's change to say, I took this information, I took this knowledge, or I spoke to this person, I learned something and changed what I did, and this is what happened as a result. And I think really, fundamentally, that's what we need. We need to keep, because I don't know about in your organizations, but I know in mine, we constantly need to make the case that it's valuable to share knowledge. Now, we all say, and we all pay lip service to the value of sharing knowledge, but actually, it's kind of, people are always, well, can you show me the rate of return? Can you show me the value of it? So there's actually some skepticism in some quarters that sharing knowledge actually contributes, despite the fact that it's really not okay to say so. So I think we do need to prove this value by collecting these stories of examples of where things change as a result of sharing knowledge, especially the tacit knowledge, where it's not, well, we produced a research report and people implemented it. It's, here it is, these people had a conversation and it changed the whole way that this project was run. So that's my quick answer on that.
I think we need to first define what we mean by knowledge, and I think Jean-Claude Monnet stated this very well yesterday with the vision and strategy on relevant, contextual, and timely. So we need to measure that. And I really like what he suggests to all of us, and I think he's doing, which is the health index on how the tools are used. It's just an example on how to measure, for example, the use of the communities of practice and platforms and networks. The other thing, this is maybe at the short run. The other thing is we need to maybe see successful as having a common language when we are talking about knowledge sharing, and still we are not there. Establish the common vision that we need to have if we wanted to have this connecting to each other from the rich experiences that we have in this community of practice around knowledge. And measure and follow networks. I think the informal networks are very, very important, and they are very difficult to measure, but knowledge happen with connecting by connecting people. So we need to be able to really have a measure to measure how the networks are operating. And in the long run, of course, it's having an impact on the quality of the reforms, on quality of education, how knowledge is having an impact on the citizen outcomes. This is what in reality we are working for. And there's several things that we need to really have in common as a community of knowledge. We shouldn't focus, I think, on the projects or interventions. We should focus, when we are measuring knowledge, on problems, and from there start measuring. The second thing that I think is very important is not to talk about best practices, but talk about how important it is in a particular context to have the fit practice that maybe we should adapt to the particular context. And the third thing is we should start not using terms like replicability, because what we are doing is bring the knowledge from other places and not replicating. We are adapting the knowledge to the particular context and scaling up for innovation. And finally, and I think maybe I'm going to be controversial a little bit here, but we should stop talking about South-South collaboration. We should talk about knowledge sharing from everywhere. It's coming from the North to South, to the South to South, to the West to South, to everywhere. I don't know where innovation is going to come from when we are talking and when we are connecting with people. It can come from many, many places, but the richness is to connect with people. And from there, to have trying to get some inspiration for innovation and for having the impact with the people that we wanted to have. So I think if we are clear on what we wanted to achieve, it would be much easier to measure results. And I think we need to start working under these principles in the area of knowledge and go out of the box for thinking in terms of how to measure informal networks, how to measure the tacit knowledge that is very difficult to capture, but we need to start thinking about it, and the connections that happen between countries to countries.
Did you want to add something? Just two quick words. First and foremost, I wanted to say that knowledge sharing of knowledge, sharing of expertise, should be done only after a study has been done, a needs assessment. That will determine then how useful that knowledge sharing can be. Sometimes also when we refer to knowledge or we refer to know-how, expertise, we might think of quite sophisticated means, quite sophisticated technological tools. But oftentimes the target group needs just small scale or very straightforward knowledge. We should avoid becoming lost in solutions that are too sophisticated, if you will. And we should also look into capacity strengthening and doing the monitoring and evaluation right away and in real time. Thank you.
In closing, I just wanted to give Amadeus and Salih an opportunity to perhaps address the question of how the development organizations, the multilaterals, the bilaterals, might assist country-led knowledge sharing. And beyond financial support, what can the agencies bring to your efforts and to enhance them?
Thank you, thank you. This is, again, important, given that we have to work together. There are initiatives which you do at the country level, but working with international organizations, you get some added advantages. Experience which I'd like to share involves particularly two organizations, UNICEF and the World Bank. We have a community of practice for Africa region, where we are working closely or supported by the World Bank and UNICEF working together, where this is a platform. It's involving more than 40 African countries. So that facilitates documenting knowledge and sharing knowledge among countries. We have virtual meetings. We also have face-to-face meetings. And in May, from 16th to 20th, we'll be hosting, in Tanzania, we'll be hosting a face-to-face meeting, which will bring more than 40 African countries, of course, working hand in hand with UNICEF and the bank. So indeed, you can see that working with international organizations also adds something, because there is knowledge which you have within a country, but with these forums, you also learn something from other fellow countries, which using your national systems or national arrangements, this can also be delivered at the lower level.
Well, it's the hour of truth with our rich experience that we have in the knowledge sharing of experience with Arab countries and with African countries. And we have an experience of a partnership with the international funds and international agencies, as I said, with J4, with the Arab Islamic Development of Bank, with the Arab League, and with the World Bank, I think. We have the decision makers here, so I will open my hand, and we're asking them to help us to share our knowledge, our expertise, at least within our community of the sub-Saharan Arab countries. Thank you.
Time is always our enemy, but the beauty is we have the rest of the day, and in the parallel sessions, we will be able to continue to share with the panelists. I thank each and every one of you, and again, thank you to the organizers for giving us this opportunity. Thank you.
Many thanks, our distinguished panels, for that very rich discussion. We are now going to move to our exciting and very sector-specific parallel sessions. Please, if you could kindly refer to your program where an assortment of sessions are available to you, please feel free to select the one that best resonates with you. We have 7 parallel sessions that will be taking place very shortly. We have 6.1 that we'll be looking at. If I may have your attention, please. Gentlemen, ladies, excuse me. Could we kindly settle in so we can give directions for the parallel sessions? Thank you. We are now going to transition to our parallel sessions. We have 7 sessions available to you. Please pick the one that is most attractive or you think will add value to where you're at. Please refer to your program because they are all in different rooms. We have 6.1, Linking Cities Through Knowledge Sharing that will take place in the MCC2137. We have session 6.2, How Knowledge Sharing Can Facilitate Education Reform, and that will take place in MCC2131. The third one is Connecting People to Solutions, Knowledge Sharing on Social Development, taking place in MC13121. 6.4 will be happening and tackling environment and climate change through systematic knowledge sharing. That will take place in MCC2125. 6.5, Learning from Transport Solutions for Scale, in MCC2135. Sharing globally, and that will focus on social protection solutions in MC4800. And finally, 6.7, Towards Effective and Sustainable Service Delivery, What Does It Take? That will take place in MCC1100. I know those rooms may sound like jargon, but we have our secretariat and ushers available in orange, remember the orange t-shirts, to guide you to your respective rooms. There are also instructions at the different elevator stops to give you further instructions. So please, let's make our way to our respective sessions of choice. You have until 12 o'clock where we will regroup at the atrium for lunch, and we will have some announcements there to guide us through the afternoon session. Coffee and refreshments are served at your respective rooms, so you will find them ready for you. And please do enjoy these sessions and participate effectively. See you over lunch break. Bye-bye.